It should go without saying that one of the most unsurprising trends of last year and now this year is that a lot of video games are getting delayed. They've been delayed, they're still getting delayed, and every time that happens, they get pushed into 2022. And when you look at the lineup of games that we should be expecting next year, it's looking stacked. There's a lot of great games coming between PS4 and PS5. Also, we're seeing a lot of these games only being available on next gen, so PS5 and series consoles. There's a lot of great stuff coming. Here's all the PS4 and PS5 games you should be looking forward to. So starting off with expected releases, and then after we'll do kind of an alphabetical list of games that are just, you know, TBA to be announced. But first up would be Elden Ring coming January 21st, 2022. We finally got a gameplay trailer not that long ago, and recently we also got new screenshots. And there was also a press showing just a few days ago showing about 15 minutes of the game, and this is something where it was not released to the public, so we don't have any new gameplay to look at, just the one trailer. But we did get some additional details on what's going on in Elden Ring, and this is one game where there's a lot of eyes on this one, a lot of anticipation, all the Souls fans just waiting for what is really, and what it's sounding like, is a culmination of Dark Souls, Bloodborne, and Sekiro, because this is a full-scale open-world game, a true open world, and there's also dungeons to explore, and these dungeons, being described right now at least, are more in the linear, somewhat linear aspect of what we saw with, like, Bloodborne, Dark Souls, right, where it's an open world, but you don't get a map, and, you know, there's more isolated straight paths, but of course you can find all these nooks and crannies and shortcuts and whatnot. That's very much what the Souls experience is, but there's a little bit of that going on in this game with the dungeons, and then you can also just go into the open world, run into a boss, run into a bunch of, you know, enemies that might be a little bit too powerful for you, and so you can come back to them later. But the also big detail that we learned is that the game now features a map. Now, this is a big deal because we've never really had this before, and the way it's approached is that it's not necessarily on screen all time where it's constantly filled in. You actually have to do that yourself as the player, which you can then mark points of interest and things like that. So it's just, the more that we hear about Elden Ring, it sounds great. I'm sure this is one where I don't have to, like, sell this to you. Everybody's just salivating for it, especially if you've played the franchise before. There's a lot of hype going into it. And then next up would be Horizon Forbidden West, because it's coming February 18th. So recently delayed, but we're looking at 2-3 months of a delay here. So it's in that first quarter of 2022. And we still only have the 8-minute gameplay demonstration from the State of Play that was a few months back, but it demonstrated a lot in that time. The lush beach environment, of course, it just looks, the game looks gorgeous. We also saw a lot of traversal methods, like climbing up or possibly gliding down. And when you're playing an open world, you want to be able to feel like you have this freedom of movement, like anything, any vantage point that you can see, you can get to at some point, and it might be easier to get to it than, say, how it was in Zero Dawn, where it was kind of awkward to shimmy your way up a mountain. And of course, with verticality, you also want to be able to go down to, say, an underwater system, right? And with an open world game, and this genre in particular, something like that's not really guaranteed, but we have that here, and so underwater exploration is huge. I can't wait to see what's going on down there, because again, Zero Dawn had these little pockets throughout that map where you could find, you know, these cool little pieces that explain more about the backstory, and I'm hoping there's a lot more of that going on here. And of course, the larger than life battles are in the game as well, as evident by, again, that 8-minute gameplay that we saw. And so Forbidden West, we should be seeing some new footage relatively soon, I would hope, but this is one game where absolutely it's going to be a heavy hitter in the PlayStation lineup. Now, another game that's coming shortly after Forbidden West is Sifu, launching February 22nd, 2022, and this beat-em-up really turned heads when it debuted during a State of Play earlier this year. It looks wonderful. The art style catches your eye almost immediately, but then you see this really clean-looking gameplay where the punches are connecting so well, and it seems like it could be smooth and very natural to play. I'm hoping that's how the game actually feels once it comes out, but this is one title where it has a really interesting mechanic, because every time you die, you age a little bit, and this is a direct metaphorical nod to the mastery of Kung Fu, because it takes time to learn, of course, and so with each failure, apparently you're supposed to come back with new moves that you couldn't do before, and so that sounds really cool. I want to see how that plays out throughout the game when it finally ships February 22nd. Next up is Evil Dead The Game, recently delayed to February 2022. The reason for that is so they can add a single player option alongside the co-op mode, which is welcomed because when this game debuted, now the trailer was good. I think it actually surprised a lot of people by just how good the game looks, but clearly that's kind of what they were trying to sell you on, was this co-op experience with these well-known characters and this, you know, established universe. And so despite it looking good, it might not be for you if it's purely a co-op game, but But the thing is, that's still how you probably want to look into this or go into the game like that anyway, because it sort of gives me Dead by Daylight vibes, where this game can come out and maybe it doesn't even have to be fantastic, right? It could be just okay or good, and you know, hopefully it won't have the technical and performance issues that Dead by Daylight had when it launched. But if this game comes out and it's just, if it's just good fun, that's all you really need, right? And so if it launches on that merit alone, then you're gonna have a lot of people having a really good time with that one. Next up is the Callisto Protocol, and this one is targeting 2022. We'll see if that ends up happening. Honestly, there's a handful of games in this list where it's a bit questionable if they will launch on time, and that's even accounting for the fact that we're, you know, a few months away from 2022, and then we still need to wait for this whole year to actually play out. So a lot can change, but there's some titles where, you know, it's a bit, we're a bit iffy on if they will, you know, release within that year, and this might be one of them. But the story behind Callisto Protocol is that this is it's Glenn Schofield's game. He's one of the previous co-creators of the Dead Space franchise, and so the idea behind this game is that it's been brewing in his head for a while. And well, this team that was formed in 2019, Striking Distance Studios, they were formed inside PUBG Studios. So if you've heard, that's why this game is supposed to take place inside the PUBG universe. I guess that was a stipulation of getting this game off the ground, because they wanted to expand the universe, and so he had this idea and they're kind of meshing them together. So not much else is known, but they do say that they want to capture the same magic and horror that Dead Space did back in 2008. And you know, that's something where you're going to want to pay attention to it and see how this one pans out if it does in fact release in 2022. Now, while we're talking about the Callisto Protocol, we can also bring up the Dead Space remake. And yes, it is indeed a remake, confirmed. It's supposed to be a remake alongside a reboot of the entire franchise, but this first game we're getting is very much the very first entry of Dead Space in 2008, remade on PS5 and the series consoles. And that sounds amazing, of course. And we're actually going to find out more info about this game later today on the upload date of this video. So until then, I can't really acknowledge that or talk about it, but we should be finding out more things later today, which is good. The one thing that we can note, though, is that Games Beat reporter Jeff Grubb did run a story about how the game is allegedly targeting a late 2022 release if development goes according to plan, which, the way that he phrased it, is not very, doesn't inspire much hope. And that's just, again, given the context of like what happened last year and this year, and most development teams are still working with now a new hybrid setup, or some are just now returning to the office. But clearly the effects of, you know, what happened throughout the last year and a half are kind of, they're going to trickle into, you know, the rest of this year and even 2022. So it's questionable if, you know, a targeted timeline like late 2022 will be comfortably met. So I almost would say that this game is definitely going to be at least, you know, early 2023 at a minimum. But either way, a remake of Dead Space, I'm all in. And that's saying a lot for me, where I don't often play horror games because they're usually too good at scaring me. But Dead Space was such an enthralling universe that I wanted to spend time in it in 2008. And I will be completely prepared to do that again in 2022 or 2023 for that matter. Now let's talk about Forspoken. This was originally called Project Athia before Square gave it a name, alongside revealing the protagonist starring actor Ella Balinska. This is supposed to be a narrative-driven adventure with an isekai sort of setup here. Luminous Productions is developing, and it is slated for sometime next year. And it looks absolutely gorgeous. It does. It's very fast-paced with the traversal. Combat seems interesting, but we just haven't really seen a whole lot of that just yet, which has led some people to think that, you know, maybe it's just a barren wasteland where all you're doing is traveling very fast and occasionally run into enemies and, you know, maybe there's not much there. I wouldn't pass that judgment too quickly because, again, we haven't really seen enough of it just yet. But based on what we have so far, like the developer, the footage, the talent involved, like Gary Wood is actually on the writing staff. I think he led the writing team for this one. Also, the fact that Sony wanted to get involved with this project and lock it down for timed exclusivity. It's just, you know, how can you not have your interest piqued just a little bit? And so even if you're kind of on the edge or you don't care too much, at the very least, you might want to wait for that next rollout of news from Square Enix, and that's where you'll probably get a better idea of like, okay, this is actually definitely something that I want to play and try next year. And hopefully it will launch on time. It seems like they're more straightforward, or they're being more forthcoming about Forspoken than our next game, which is Final Fantasy 16. Although they have actually been, they've been doing more talking about this one recently. But the problem with Final Fantasy 16 is that there is no official release window being thrown out there just yet, not even a year. All we have is the one trailer we got during the September PS5 showcase, but that one trailer was pretty meaty. So we got a lot of gameplay, a lot of in-game cutscenes, so much so that any criticism towards the graphics quality sort of tells you that the game is coming along smoothly, instead of presenting a polished vertical slice where behind the scenes, maybe the rest of it is really rough. We saw what looked like various portions of the game looking relatively okay, and that's good. Mind you, the relatively okay is in relation to, again, just sort of the performance and how the game looked. You know, the game's gonna get touched up a lot more up until release, which is what Square was talking about as recently as, I think, 1 or 2 months ago, something like that, where they, again, they were a bit more candid about how the next time they show the game, they want it in a more polished state. But they're also talking about the next time that they do debut it, we'll probably see more of the combat, and also they're finishing up, I believe, the English voice talent. So even though they're not showing it, they're just discussing how, yeah, the game's coming along rather smoothly. But in terms of gameplay and what we saw, I mean, it was exciting, right? I mean, I think the game looks really good, actually. So based on everything that we just went over, despite the fact that this game does not have a targeted release window or release year for that matter, you can see that they're probably trying to get this out before 2022 is over. I feel like between Forspoken and FF16, these games are going to be coming sooner rather than later. Next up, let's talk about Ghostwire Tokyo, another game that was recently delayed to early 2022, and this is also another case of one trailer-itis. And I think there's maybe some concern here because when we saw Ikumi Nakamura leave Tango Gameworks in 2019, she was the creative director up to that point, but I'm still hopeful that we've got something special coming here with the faster-paced action-adventure mixed in with light horror elements and walking the streets of an empty Tokyo. It sounds right up my alley. I'm just not sure if this game will actually launch early 2022. I could see it doing another, you know, 3-4 month delay, but that's because we have one trailer and that's it. So by the end of this year, if we get another trailer, and let's say it's a thorough gameplay walkthrough, or we just see, you know, more of like the story unfolding or the opening sequence or whatever, if we get something, that'll instill some confidence of like, okay, well, sounds like the game will actually launch, you know, the first quarter of next year, and in that case, I'm ready to go. Now for this next one, God of War, I mean, of course it was in here, it's just that we've got nothing for it. Absolutely nothing. We've got no trailer, we've got no trailer. We had, the game was supposed to launch this year, which we all didn't think that was going to happen. Every person imaginable was like, okay, but like 2022 though was recently confirmed. So we have the slight little teaser that was revealed during the September PS5 event. And that was, you know, nearly a year ago now at this point. So we should probably see, at the very least, like a cinematic type teaser or something. Well, no, maybe that's not entirely true, because our first introduction to the 2018 God of War was a very thorough gameplay walkthrough. So I feel like once we see this game, we're probably going to get a very significant look at it in some way. Or at least that's sort of how I would expect it, kind of like also Horizon Forbidden West, right? I think that's kind of where Sony is right now when it comes to, you know, revealing and showcasing their games. And I feel like some people at this point are, you know, kind of getting tired with having to wait so long to see their games. But by and large, when we saw Ratchet and Clank or even, you know, Gran Turismo 7, like, we got some gameplay, just straight gameplay that was uninterrupted, you know, very few cuts, and so God of War will probably see the same introduction. And with Gran Turismo being said, we can also say Gran Turismo 7. Now, this is also a game where, now for me personally, not a fan. I'm not a driving simulator fan. Gran Turismo is tough for me. I don't know, maybe I should try and get into it again with like a really good racing wheel that has a proper turning radius, and because I love cars, but I like the arcadey racers, and so maybe Gran Turismo will be more for me if I try and play it like that. But this is still a huge franchise for PlayStation, so it's really one of those things where you're in one of two camps. You just don't care whatsoever, I'm kind of in that area, or you cannot wait for this game, because this game moves units on PlayStation every single time, and the good thing here is that it is slated for 2022, launching on PS4 as well, and for Gran Turismo, this is the first time where this game, well, the first time in a long time where a Gran Turismo entry is going to show up relatively soon into the new platform cycle, a new PlayStation cycle. And so if the game launches at any point in 2022, that will already be, it's going to be much better off than, you know, the last two or three entries in this franchise. Now, this next one is kind of like Gran Turismo for me. I don't care too much for it, but you can tell that there is a lot of enthusiasm going into this, or there's a lot of people that are really waiting for this to come out, which is Hogwarts Legacy. And when this was revealed during PS5's either the September event or the main event, but if you remember, I recorded both of my reactions to those events. And when Hogwarts Legacy came up, I, you know, recognized it, like, oh, okay, here's that Harry Potter game that's been in development for a while. But I made some sort of offhanded comment about, like, do people really, you know, want this, or who asked for this? Something weird, right? Which I guess that was like way off base, or I was super out of touch with just how, you know, popular Harry Potter is, or at least the desire of wanting a proper video game adaptation for it, right? So the trailer for this game on YouTube on Sony's official channel sits at like 10, 15 million views, a huge like to dislike bar. So clearly a lot of people looking forward to it. The only problem is that this game was delayed at the start of 2021. Now, keep in mind, that's the start of 2021. They already knew they were not going to release this game this year. So with the one trailer and the very early delay of saying, yeah, no chance we're making it this year when the year only started. Not to say that the game won't ship in 2022, but there seems to be a certain factor here that says the game needs a good amount of time in development. So if we don't get a trailer anytime soon, I'm not sure how likely a release in 2022 will be, but that's definitely one where we're supposed to get it next year. And for the sake of everyone that wants it, I hope you do get it. Next is a new untitled Sonic Team game coming sometime next year. It is confirmed, but all we have is that infamous teaser trailer. So much like God of War, we can't really say much else beyond what we have, which is very, very little. And really, this is very similar to God of War because that was announced too early. Well, that teaser was shown off too early, right? Saying 2021. And, you know, that wasn't going to happen. And same deal here where the studio head, Takashi Iizuki, admitted that the game was announced too early. So we have a new Sonic game coming. That's good. Sonic fans are excited, especially because when you look at that franchise history, it's rocky. There's no denying that. We've had a lot of misfires in the Sonic universe, so we're hoping this one's good, right? I mean, that's always the hope when a new Sonic game is announced, and we should be seeing one in 2022. Now, this one might surprise you, but Stranger of Paradise Final Fantasy Origin. I think this game is the epitome of you should never judge a book by its cover, because yes, that initial trailer was underwhelming. You know, it was kind of cringy with the chaos left and right and the way the characters were presented. And then just overall, from a visual point of view, it's underwhelming, of course. You know, when you hear the Final Fantasy name, I think there's an expectation of what the game looks like, whether that's a spinoff on a Nintendo handheld where you think, okay, chibi, 2D art style, sprites, you know, whatever. Or if it's Final Fantasy on a home console, you expect bright, vivid, you know, these amazing visual effects and these crazy good looking cutscenes. And that's not really what's here, of course, because this is supposed to be some sort of, you know, action oriented Souls-like Final Fantasy is kind of how it's being described. But once the demo actually came out on PS5, which the first few days it actually didn't even work, which was hilarious. But once the demo was fixed and you were able to play it, it's not bad. Like, I'm sitting there going through it and I'm like, I think I like this. Which is not even, I guess it's not even a super flattering comment, but there's enough there to pique your interest. And really, you know, despite the bad trailer, despite the poor initial impression, if it's fun, it's fun. And that's why Final Fantasy Origin is definitely on my radar, and I think it should be on your radar too if you didn't have the chance to play the demo. Next up, this one's probably going to be a Game of the Year favorite for me, and I know that's so early to say, but it's Stray. So this game, when we initially saw it during the first PS5 event, you know, we saw a cat, it was a teaser trailer, not much else. Now, of course, that sold me right away when I saw the cat, but that's not going to be enough for most people. You need to see more, and that recent gameplay demonstration, that's where I think not only was I completely sold, but I think that's where everybody else was like, oh yeah, we're getting down with this big time. You are totally a cat up in that dystopian world. You are solving puzzles, you're running away from enemies, you're fighting enemies, you're soliciting pets from these robots. It's just, there's a lot of elements and layers to this game that every single one of them I would like to immerse myself in. And it's just easily GOTY material for me. I don't really know what other way to put it. Maybe to dial back a little bit, it looks like a really great game. And that's one where, oh yeah, I'm absolutely playing that day one. And I think actually a lot of people are gonna be in the same position that I am. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you haven't yet, please subscribe for the best PlayStation news, reviews, and updates that are here on YouTube. And you can also follow me on Twitter at Mystic Ryan. And that is it. I will see you all in my next video. You take it easy. Oh. Yeah, it's my